Hello, everybody. Welcome into Talking Fitchburg on this Friday, April 16th, 2021. Good Friday evening, everybody. Hope you had a wonderful day. Glad you're tuning in here for Talking Fitchburg. We've got a jam-packed show for you coming up today. We'll get you the latest headlines here as we work into the weekend. We're going to take a look back at this week's Telecommunicators Week. We want to highlight and make sure you have a chance to learn a little bit more about our telecommunicators right here in the city of Fitchburg. We have dispatchers in the police department. I'll check with Chad Brecklin as we look back at an interview we did earlier this week. Plus, we're going to check in with Kimberly over at the Fitchburg Star. She'll be here giving us an update what's going on here for recent meetings and other news in Fitchburg. So fun to get to news people together and start talking. We always have a good time talking with Kimberly. So we'll get to that here in just a little bit of time. For your headlines as we go into the weekend, we start with the blood drive. Want to make sure you get this on your calendar. We are thrilled, it says here, from the Fitchburg Fire Department to be hosting the Oak Banks annual blood drive again this year at station number 2 at Marketplace Drive on Friday, May 7th from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. You can schedule today. Yeah, today you can get scheduled for this. And that's at rcblood.org. And you can look for the city of Fitchburg or, you know, they have kind of a map of where there'll be blood drives going on. But a great way to get signed up early and help save a life, donate blood. And that will help anybody and everybody who needs it. All right, over at the Fitchburg or Fish Hatchery Road and the Fitchburg construction update, we did have one of those yesterday with Andrew McFadden. But quickly, if you didn't get a chance to see or haven't drove through that area, we've got some video here to show you exactly what that looks like. A new traffic pattern was put in place starting on Tuesday. This is north and south of Fish Hatchery Road construction. Now share the southbound lanes. And Andrew was kind enough to grab the new Fact TV van and pass his way through here. So you can see it's side by side traffic, one lane in each direction going through the construction here. And you can see on the northbound side, they are doing that construction. So all of that construction happening on your right there happens all the way through mid-July or July, all weather dependent, of course. There is access, of course, to the businesses and apartment complexes that are on the northbound side. So you can take care of that. And yeah, it's not, it seems like it should be longer, but really it's pretty easy to navigate in and out of there. Just plan ahead when you're coming into those construction zones. Stay safe. Know that some of the bus stops have changed as well. So some of them have either been removed temporarily or, again, the points are a little bit different. So check ahead if you are using the public transportation there, as those have changed. All right, continue with Severe Weather Awareness Week in Wisconsin. Today's final severe weather awareness tip is heat safety. And being prepared is ensuring you have the capacity to take care of your needs through an emergency. We seem to have more and more warm days out there ahead. So I want to make sure that you understand heat safety and what's going on. So heat can equal heat exhaustion and heat stroke. The number one cause of weather-related fatalities in the U.S. is heat, and that's why it's included in the severe weather. It is a severe when it does hit, and especially if it hits for long periods of time. And especially, too, you add in other things like dew points in air temperatures and even at night. Some of these really dangerous heat events, it can be hard to breathe and or get cooled down. So make sure you drink plenty of water during heat events. Check on your neighbors and friends. Help move storm windows and install air conditioning units for those who need it. Check the back seat for babies. 10 minutes is all it takes for a baby to pass away from heat exhaustion or just heat-related incidents. So got to check the back seats every time you head out. And of course, the most vulnerable people are elderly, infants, and young children, people with disabilities who use certain medications, those who are outdoors in the hot setting, and individuals who are air conditioning that they don't use or have existing AC. All those can be problem areas. So act fast to save lives during that. And when we know there's hot weather coming in, we always jump in here on Talking Fitchburg and make sure that you can stay safe. All right, that does it for our headlines. Coming up next, we open up our digest. We'll take a look back at an interview we did this week about our telecommunicators for Telecommunicators Appreciation Week. It's right here on Talking Fitchburg.
We're all just trying to keep things running for those who rely on us.
Ready!
That's why we don't have time to be sick with the flu. And especially this year, no one has time to get sick. Get a flu shot for yourself and those around you too.
I may never have met you. We don't go way back. Maybe we wouldn't even be friends if we did. But when you wear a mask, you have my respect. Because your mask doesn't protect you. It protects me. I wear my mask to protect you. Mask up, America.
Gaining weight was easy. All I had to do was sit down and eat. Losing weight's a lot harder. I have to work at it every day. But with every step, I lower my risk for type 2 diabetes and heart disease. And that makes every step, every choice, every day very much worth the effort.
Learn how you can help stop diabetes by losing weight, eating healthy, and staying active. Visit checkupamerica.org or call 1-800-DIABETES.
You need to do something to feel okay to drive. You're not okay to drive. Don't drive buzzed.
Welcome back into Talking Fitchburg. Joining me today from the Fitchburg Police Department on a special visit, Chad Brecklin, Fitchburg Police Department. Chad, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing today, Jeremy?
I am doing wonderful, and I'm so glad that we can sneak in for a quick interview here this week. And as we talk about a public safety communicators week here, it's said so many different ways, I feel like, but the need and the awareness is so important. Tell us about, what is a telecommunicator? What's a dispatcher? Maybe people might familiarize themselves with more of that.
Yeah, I think it was appropriate for you to use those two terminologies because they are often used in the same vein to describe the same role, that being obviously either a police dispatcher in our case or police telecommunicator. But we have our own full-time dispatch center that we staff here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And this week is National Public Safety Telecommunicators Week, running April 11th through the 17th. And we have four full-time telecommunicators and about five or six part-time telecommunicators, all of who are dedicated professionals who are keeping our center staff 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And they are the people that you have your first point of contact with whenever you call our non-emergency police number.
Yeah, it's an important role. And if there was a role that I would say that is multitasking, you know, there's a few of those. I think of, like, you know, somebody that works in a control tower at an airport. And then I think of a 911 center or dispatch area. Talk about some of their roles, because I think a lot of people, you make some assumptions about what's going on, what isn't going on, if they're just sitting on the other side of the radio. That job is, man.
It would be hard to accurately grab all of the potential job duties that they may have in a position description. It is truly one of those unique roles in any organization, really, where they wear so many different hats at any given time. So for our telecommunicators, they're going to be answering the phone. They could be answering the phone for another city department or monitoring an alarm for another city department. They're going to be liaisoning with our 911, the Dane County Public Safety Communication Center downtown. They're going to be taking radio calls and relaying information from our police officers here in Fitchburg. They might be also monitoring radio traffic in other communities that may be nearby. They could be engaged in, doing some data searches for our police officers or case searches through our computer systems. I mean, it's all kinds of different things that they could be doing at any given time. Somebody during business hours could walk up to the window and request some sort of service from the police department. So, you know, they can never necessarily anticipate when all of these things are going to come together. It's not typically spread out over the course of their shift. It usually ebbs and flows, and inevitably they're asked to do about 15 different things over about a 5 minute span or less, really, probably about a 5 second span, it seems to them, I'm sure. But it takes a special person who really has a desire to serve and possesses a good, well-rounded skill set and a whole lot of patience to do that job.
Yeah, it's, I think two words come to mind. Sky's the limit on what you do. And when it rains, it pours, because you just never know when all of those things are going to come together. But a thankless job. And yet we're so thankful on the dedicated hours and things that are happening there. You could call it the brains of the operation. You sit here as police chief and you got to watch your organization stuff, but the day-to-day operations that are running through there are so crucial in what's happening with your operations. When you're thinking and you're going to thank these people for everything they do, what's going on your mind as chief of police and the amazing job that they're doing?
Well, again, it takes a special person to be in that role, one who is willing to really be the first point of contact and be the go-between between a whole bunch of different individuals and a bunch of different bits of information, be willing to be a little bit part detective, a little bit part problem solver, a little bit part customer service representative, know all of the various operations within the department and where to route calls and those sorts of things. And, try to decipher sometimes what can be a little bit of an unclear, request for service when someone calls. And then there are, of course, critical emergencies that they're also responsible for dispatching and or being involved in radio traffic, where the stress level can be beyond what most of us would typically really experience in our lives. So it's definitely a very critical job. It holds a very special place in the department to kind of, again, be that glue that kind of keeps everything moving and together. And again, we can't thank those folks enough for what they do. They're truly a valuable piece of our organization.
Yeah, truly are. And, there's so much that has happened and changed in the police world, but one thing that stays the same is that person in that and the role that they provide. Finally, Chad, as we wrap up, and again, thank everybody in the organization, but really, strive this. Do you see any changes in the future in the telecommunications? Are we going to see more video? Right now it's a lot of radio traffic and that sort of thing, but do you see any changes as far as that comes as the future of telecommunications? Because it's a role that to me is only going to get and develop and gets bigger just by its nature. But the technology around and stuff's got to be pretty cool as that comes forth.
Yeah, I mean, there's already been quite a lot of technological advances, as you can imagine, between the different technology related to radio systems. Already we've tried to utilize technology to our benefit from a dispatching perspective with computers and squad cars and an ability for dispatchers and officers to communicate via messaging systems within those records management and or mobile applications. And, some of the newest technology that's now beginning to enter 911 centers, such as the one downtown in downtown Madison, is the ability to text a 911 center versus calling. And I think that's a very important piece that's coming into play here and becoming much more widespread, where it allows a potential crime victim who is not in a position to be able to make a phone call, but can summons either police, fire, or EMS resources, or all of them, utilizing the text messaging feature of their cell phone. So I would say that's probably the most notable thing that's, becoming more and more common that we'll see over the next few years. And, a lot of smart people out there in the world that are coming up with all sorts of technological advances. So it's hard for me to even begin to predict what the next thing might be.
another reason to just say thank you and happy that they're there to help us day in and day out. Exactly. Chad, thank you so much for your time. Please tell all of the dispatchers down there thank you for what they do, and appreciate you jumping on here and sharing some of the stories of all the great work they do.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me on, Jeremy. I appreciate it.
You bet. Chad Brocklin, your chief of police here. And again, we're so thankful that the men and women working in our telecommunications here, right here in the city of Fitchburg, are there and happy to answer the call, even in the middle of the night. Just saying, they're there for you. We'll take a quick break. More to come. You're watching Talking Fitchburg.
You could be spreading the coronavirus without realizing you have it. So follow guidance from authorities where you live and do your part. It's important to limit in-person interaction with anyone outside of your immediate household, but phone and video chat are safe ways to connect. It's also important to limit any social gathering. This advice applies to people of any age, including teens and younger adults. Visit coronavirus.gov for the latest information.
After you joined our family, it was like, I really do feel complete now.
Our hearts are made stronger by how we treat others.
Put her there.
The light you share can impact those around you, but so can the darkness.
Later, twerps!
Did Pete saying mean things bother you?
So when you reach out to another person, take a moment to consider how they will feel and let your heart be the key to making a difference. Because of you, someone's entire day, year, or even life can change.
In every heart, there's hope.
We're all just trying to keep things running for those who rely on us.
Ready!
That's why we don't have time to be sick with the flu. And especially this year, no one has time to get sick. Get a flu shot for yourself and those around you too.
It takes all of us to slow the spread of the coronavirus. So follow guidance from authorities where you live and stay home unless absolutely necessary. Use a delivery service for essential items like food and medicine. If you must make essential trips, stay 6 feet apart from other people. Wear a cloth face covering and wash your hands for at least 20 seconds as often as possible. Visit coronavirus.gov for the latest information.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back into Talking Fitchburg. Joining me today for the Fitchburg Star, we got Kimberly back on the show. Kimberly, how are you doing today?
Well, considering we filmed this the day before, today I'm doing pretty great.
Don't tell our secrets on the show, Kimberly.
On today, Friday, we'll see, because I'll be getting my COVID vaccine later today. So later today as in Thursday. So tomorrow I might not be feeling great, so I can't really answer that for you. We're just crossing our fingers.
I'm crossing your fingers. You know, hopefully, even if you do, they won't be too bad and clear up quickly. But congratulations that you are getting that taken care of. And you're going to take care of us here on Talking Fitchburg with a council recap. There's been so many things happening. So we'll jump right into it. We said goodbye to some alders, and we got some new alders coming in. Tell us what you know on that front.
Yeah, so there were two alders who were automatically planning to leave, right? Sarah Schroeder in District 3 was not going to run again. And same with Tom Clotter, he was not going to run again either. So you were automatically gonna have two new people join the council regardless of who won elections. Dorothy Krause is also leaving the council in District 1. And so she will be replaced by Dave Erbst. Dave has been on the Board of Public Works for really, you know, multiple decades. I don't want to necessarily get this wrong, but if I remember right, it's been about three decades, close to that he's been on the Board of Public Works. And so he'll be taking over for District 1. Jay Allen will be taking over for District 3. It was kind of an interesting race to follow, considering his opponent had decided that if she won the seat, she was not going to take it. So if Jay had lost, they would have had to look into different options, such as a special election, appointing someone, something like that. So with Jay winning, that kind of negated the need for that. And then replacing Tom Clotter is Jim Wheeler. You're actually trading out a former police officer for a former police officer. So District 4 will have its police officer presence, even though neither one of them are active anymore. So, and then in District 2, Julia Arratafrato won re-election against opponent Stephen Heller. Stephen is on the plan commission. So everyone sort of had a tie to the city when they were running in contested races. So I think Jim is truly the only newcomer in the sense that Jay Allen has been involved with the city before. So yeah, definitely some changes coming to the council. 3 out of 8 people turning over.
Yeah, and if you want to catch the council, it was a little bit later in the evening, but the last council meeting, the outgoing members got a nice send-off, and also all of them had a chance to say their goodbyes, if you will, and thanks. Pretty heartwarming moment there, especially from Dorothy, who serves several years. I think it was 10 years. So either way, you can check that out here at Fact TV. Another on top of our city council stuff happening, we also had our city administrator stuff going on as well. I had a nice candidate. I'm gonna call it a forum, even though it wasn't really. It was get to know your candidate, if you will. Yeah. Tell us what you know on our city administration front.
Yes. Well, I don't want to. I might accuse Aaron of copying our Fact TV format, because they, the four candidates last week, that would have been April 8th. They all came to council chambers and they sat at the dais. And they answered questions. They had 3 minutes, which sounds very familiar to what we had. But they answered different questions about, you know, why they want to be with the city, you know, what integrity means to them, following up on that survey they asked. So you will have one of four of these candidates as your next city administrator. They are Chad Brecklin, who is the current City of Fitchburg Police Chief, Matthew Prowl, who is the current IT manager, Eric, I'm going to butcher this name, but Eric Reinfleisch, who is the City of Onalaska administrator, and then Andre Small, who is the Madison Water Utility customer service supervisor. They talked about it in closed session on last Tuesday for who they wanted to hire, and Aaron is expected to announce who they selected at some point next week. There's no guarantee when that's going to arrive, but whoever it is, they will find out next week. So, and on April 27th, it's expected that they will, the new council will vote on a contract for whoever is a new administrator. So.
Yeah, a lot to go. And if you did, great candidates, by the way. I happen to be running the event here on Fact TV, but I had a chance to talk to everybody, and all great candidates. If you have a chance and you want to learn more about them, we've got that up there for you to watch. But it was a nice group of candidates selected there. Finally, public transit survey has been out there, and we've been talking about it here on Talking Fitchburg, but you can help us break it down a little bit about what this is all about.
So there are actually two of them out there. One is the City of Fitchburg's transit survey, and they're looking at just for Fitchburg residents or people who use the Fitchburg lines to tell the City of Fitchburg and advise whether they feel that they would like more access, whether they would like more, you know, more like routes more frequently, whether they would like to utilize ride shares instead of Mass and Metro. And then the City of Madison, so Madison Metro has its own survey as well, because they are working on doing a complete rerouting of the system to make it more efficient. They're going to have to decide ultimately, when it comes down to it, whether they want to, how they want to balance having more coverage for the largest number of riders, or increasing ridership in general. So you've got both of these entities looking at how people actually use public transit. And so if you use public transit, this is really going to matter to you. So it's really important that you fill out those surveys, especially the City of Fitchburg one, and definitely look for the Madison Metro one as well, because they will all help form the future of public transit in the city. So, and in the region.
Absolutely. Yeah. But all of those surveys are available right on our website, fitchburgwi.gov. If you want to check those out, check out what the transportation group is doing in the breakdown of what Kimberly was just talking about. So definitely check those out. Kimberly, for those who aren't familiar with, knowing that you can get just more than the paper, where can people find you at and stay up on all of Fitchburg's news besides right here on Talking Fitchburg?
Right. This is all you need. Just kidding. There is so much good stuff on connectfitchburg.com, and not to like really plug our website, but there's a neat story about a dog groomer that just went up. We have stats about the election, 28% turnout, which whenever it's not 100% turnout, I feel really sad. So we're working towards 100% Fitchburg, but yeah, there's so many different stories on connectfitchburg.com that we just don't have time to do here, but there's plenty out there and we update it every single week. When you get to our website, you can also sign up for our newsletter that always comes out on Thursday morning. So you can always stay updated that way too.
Fantastic. And we'll keep everybody updated when you join us in a couple of weeks. So we appreciate your time, Kimberly, as always. Stay safe. Good luck on the vaccine. And next time we see you, maybe you'll be a mutant. That's what I was hoping for. Like I'd be some like cool, maybe an extra arm or something, but didn't happen. Not yet. Still,
the extra arm would actually be really useful as I'm sitting here trying to type and multitask. So
right? That's what I say.
Maybe that would be useful. So no, more so the benefit here is, getting back out in the community, because it's been really hard to just to not be near everyone, to not go to, Concerts at McKee and Fitchburg Festival of Speed and the Burby Derby, right? So this vaccination for me is just one step closer to being back in Fitchburg more often and just loitering at the Starbucks. So that's what it breaks down to. So
yeah, no, it's so helpful for getting out. We're here at Fact TV too. We are looking so much forward to getting out back into the community and covering all the great things that are happening. So congratulations on that. And we'll see you in a couple of weeks. Thank you so much, Kimberly.
See you in a few weeks, guys.
You bet. Kimberly from the Fitchburg Star, again, check out their website and sign up for that newsletter so you can get the latest each and every week. Take a quick break. More to come. You're watching Talking Fitchburg.
I expected it to be a lot easier.
I thought it was going to be a piece of cake. I didn't know what step to take next.
I was transitioning from the military.
I was a vehicle gunner.
An avionics specialist.
I was an MP, military police.
My friends thought I could do anything.
I missed my unit. My family.
Playing with my daughter, I felt like a stranger.
I was overwhelmed.
I couldn't sleep.
I just wanted to be by myself.
I didn't have a clear sense of what to do next.
I was too proud.
And then I thought, if I'm going through this, other veterans have gone through it too.
Right?
I started to open up.
And it made a huge difference.
So I reached out and I saw that I wasn't alone.
Because before I was able to take on my next mission, I had to take on just taking care of myself.
To find
purpose.
We are not alone. Other veterans have transitioned from the military and overcome mental health challenges. Visit maketheconnection.net.
Welcome back into Talking Fitchburg. Wrapping up the show for the day, I want to thank, of course, Chad Breckham from the Fitchburg Police Department, our police chief, and talking about the telecommunicators here in the city of Fitchburg. Thank you to everybody who does and takes on that role. You are awesome. And also want to thank Kimberly from the Fitchburg Star. Always fun to catch up with her. Make sure you check out their website and sign up for that newsletter if you want to get weekly news updates. As we wrap up here, how can you stay connected? Well, we've got our resources here. You just got to find us. And we hope we'll see you there next week.